going to start off with Pat, and thank you for being here.
All right, thank you. What I want to do is give you an introduction to this new initiative that our office is starting, the Targeted External Faculty Award Program. The goal of this program is to increase recognition of distinguished faculty, to increase Texas Tech's national and international visibility, to be more like AAU institutions, and then, of course, ultimately to achieve Tier 1 status. And having faculty get recognized for top awards will help us achieve this. So how are we going about doing this? Well, we're developing a dedicated awards process for the submission and tracking of faculty nominations. And we want this process to be centralized, systematic, and proactive. And previously, what would happen is solicitations for awards would come in to various places on campus, might be the president or the or Rob Duncan or one of the deans, and then they would send it out to people they thought were relevant in order to identify a potential nominee. And nobody really knew what the other person was doing. And so with this new process, it's centralized, and it's also systematic, so we've got things on a timeline, and proactive, so we're not scrambling at the last minute to meet the deadline. We also have an incentive program for these top-tier awards. This list shows the targeted awards. There are incentives for this, which I'll go over in a minute, but the reason why these are on the list is because they are recognized by the Center for Measuring University Performance, the American Association of Universities, and the Texas Higher Education Coordinating Board. So these organizations, when they evaluate universities, they look to see if they've gotten these awards. And there are others too, but these are the ones that we've targeted. The incentives include up to $25,000 for demonstrated relocation expenses. This is covered by the offices of the provost and vice president for research. And so faculty, if they're doing, let's say a Fulbright and need to relocate, they can apply for up to $25,000 to help them. Also, faculty will get a one-time $5,000 bonus for getting one of these awards, and that's funded by central administration. The expectations that go along with these incentives is to provide a written report to the provost and vice president for research within a certain amount of time, 2 months after concluding the activities, and then also the expectation to help other faculty and give advice for those who want to apply for the same awards. But this does not preclude colleges or units from providing their own incentives for discipline-specific awards, but we just don't have the resources to do that. As part of going after these targeted awards, some of them would require developmental leave, and for those, we would use an expedited developmental leave process. What that means is that the request would be evaluated separately from the standard developmental leave process, the one that comes out with the deadline in October and everybody submits and then goes to a committee. This would be, for these target awards, it'd be separate. It can be done in between cycles, so it doesn't have to be submitted by October 1st, which is the standard, but it would still need to get approved by the Board of Regents. This is a list of some of the other targeted awards, but we don't have incentives for these because those organizations that I listed earlier don't really count these when evaluating for Tier 1. However, these are still highly prestigious, and we still want people to go after these. By the way, there is a handout with my slides, and so you can get that. You have to read vertically instead of horizontally. Printed it the wrong way. And if you want a copy of this electronically, I can send that. So what are some of the specific actions we've taken? We have come up with a process where we're going to follow a master timeline for nominations and submission for all these targeted awards. And so we have this huge calendar, and we've identified when people need to submit their reference letters, when they need to submit their proposals, get approval from the president if applicable, and so on. So we're using this master timeline to meet our milestones. We've also come up with procedural documents for each of the awards. And so if we were to go to our website, there's a link to all these awards right here. And then if you scroll down, you'll see that for each of the awards, it says what the targeted disciplines are, what the deadline is. And then there's also a document that you can open that has a synopsis of that award in terms of eligibility, in terms of the materials that you need to submit, in terms of the timelines. And then, so the first page is typically, this is a little bit atypical. These don't have particular timelines on them. Let me go to a different one. So the National Medal of Technology and Innovation. You can see it gives you the links to the overview, the guidelines, eligibility, what you need to submit. And then on the second page, there's a timeline to advise people what needs to be done when. So this is available for each of the awards on that list. And that just is hope to save people time so they don't have to search all over the organization's website. We're also considering adding additional useful information to our website, such as FAQs, tips, names of prior winners, things like that. We've also asked all the deans to see if they can come up with or put together a committee that is focused on faculty award nominations, external nominations. Most departments have internal award committees, but not external awards. So we've asked people to do this so that they have a dedicated group of people that try to find faculty who they can put up for these top awards. We've also asked the deans to get their departments to send us a list of nominations and awards that they have done in the past 3 years, because right now there is no record of awards. There's no institutional record of what awards people have gotten and what people have been nominated for. So in order to sort of assess how we're doing, we need a baseline. And so we've asked for records from each department for the past 3 years. In addition, at the Research Advisory Council, we asked the members there to every month give me a list of, you know, who have you nominated this month, who has gotten awards this month, so we again can track things. And then from faculty who submit applications for these awards, we're going to ask them to submit the nomination application packet to Office of Research Services, who will then enter that into the CAIU system so that we do have an official institutional record of these nominations. Most recently, we have appointed Dr. Kelly Phelan of the College of Human Sciences, who will act as the coordinator for Fulbright grant opportunities. Kelly has had a Fulbright, she's very passionate about Fulbrights, and so her charge is to help faculty submit more applications for Fulbright. Fulbright is one of these target awards, very prestigious, and a couple of years ago we had 10 Fulbright award winners, which was the highest ever for the university, and also the highest of any public university. So we really excel there, and we want to keep doing that. She is available to meet with faculty or department chairs or deans to give informational meetings about Fulbright and help in any other way when it comes to Fulbright. So she is our go-to person for that grant. What's coming next is we purchased the software called Competition Space. This software is designed specifically for competitions. So it allows people to send out memos that solicit names of faculty who might be worthy of nomination. You can send out emails on a scheduled basis to remind references to write their letters and submit them. For example, you can collect all the nomination documents, put it in one place. And so this should be very helpful. It's going to be used for limited submissions, and then also kind of internal awards and also these external awards. So that's going to be coming down the pipe probably in the spring. We are available to provide informational meetings of your choosing, whether you want to target it to a specific award, whether you want a general presentation, and it could be to faculty, chairs, deans, however you want to do it. We're also thinking about putting together some internal reviewer panels where award winners, previous award winners, can review, look at proposals of those who are applying. So that's something we're thinking about doing. And of course, we're always open to suggestions. It'd be very helpful if people, if all the departments on campus would encourage faculty to submit nominations for these top awards, and to you know, to help us increase the number of nominations we put out there. The Vice President for Research also wants to see departments do what I'm doing at the department level for discipline-specific awards. So we don't do anything with discipline-specific awards. We don't have the resources to do that. So Rob Duncan would like each of the departments to try to do that internally so that we can increase recognition and also to track these nominations. Some of the things that we'd like to work on is, and of course feedback is welcome, is you know, how can we increase the nominations? People are busy, it takes time to submit nominations, write up nomination packets, and so whatever we can do to help this, we want to know about it. And if there's any suggestions for resources or information that we can provide that would help faculty navigate this nomination process, like finding the awards, knowing how to apply, things like that. And then just knowing what other kinds of informational meetings would be helpful. So that's all I have. And I don't know, do we open for questions? Or
if anybody has
does anybody questions. Have any questions? Okay. Well, thank you for your time.
Thank you, Pat. Next, we have Chancellor of Facility Planning and Instruction, Michael Molina, to talk about the research part.
We have Duncan first.
Oh, we have Duncan first. Okay. And then we'll hear from Michael Molina.
Hello, I'm sorry I can't be with you today for this roundtable discussion, but I wanted to be sure we kicked it off in a manner that really gets to the heart of some really exciting opportunities for us that are ahead. Now, Research Park Building is a great opportunity and very exciting, but what's even more so is this, if you will, innovation hub that Texas Tech is establishing that will operate around the Research Park. And it's that buzz, it's that engagement of our faculty, our students, staff, and administration that really, to me, seems to be really quite invigorating. I think you'll agree as you find out more about that. As of October 10th, the Office of Research Commercialization, which had been at the system level, has now moved on to campus at Texas Tech University and will report through me to the administration at Texas Tech University on our campus. The importance of this is it will embed the commercialization process into the fabric of what we do academically. So this whole process will be much more under the direct control of the faculty, and I want to really encourage the faculty to be very involved in this. Russell Thomason, who will lead this office, has been quite active in appointing a committee, an advisory committee, to this research commercialization process. And on that committee are faculty that have had the most critical approach and are the most concerned, frankly, about making improvements so this process runs better. That's our absolute commitment. We can't achieve that without your direct engagement from the faculty. So please be sure and engage not only with these members of the advisory committee that are working with the Office of Research Commercialization, but also with the office itself and with me, because we want to be sure that this process really serves the needs of the faculty quite effectively. If you look 25 years ago, 75% of all the R&D 100 awards were made to major industry, typically Bell Labs, IBM, etc. Today, 75% go to public institutions, primarily universities. So today, a shift has occurred where most of the early phase basic research is conducted at major universities. And so it's our responsibility to be sure we translate this basic phase research into opportunities that can really create the next big thing, the new products, the new services, the new opportunities that will really be of profound importance to us all. So again, the take-home message, and I'm sorry I can't be with you right now today, but the take-home message is this process will meet the needs of the faculty as the faculty actively and critically engage at this point in time. I encourage you all to be very much a part of that. I thank the staff and the Office of Research Services and the staff and the Office of Research Commercialization across the entire research office in looking to, again, this administrative integration that will make it possible for us to much more directly meet the needs, not only the faculty in terms of commercializing their discoveries, but also the desire of the entire community to be much, much more entrepreneurial. And again, come May 2015, we'll have a huge opportunity with the addition of our new research park. So there'll be much more discussion of this today. Sorry I can't be with you, but please be actively engaged in this. We very much value and we require, without your input, this process won't be the integrated process with the faculty that we all envision it to be. Well, thank you and take care. I hope you have a really good roundtable discussion today.
What you're seeing here is a virtual walkthrough of our new research building. Appreciate it. First of all, that music is not going to be piped in the building 24 hours a day on a rolling scale, so that's just for the video.
And a couple other points, the color scheme is not exact. So if you saw some purples with pinks and peaches, it's not necessarily the scheme. We're just trying to show some depth and scale in the building. When over 2 years ago, a few of you were on the committee to try to visualize what does this research park dream need to be. And we literally master planned about 120 acres worth of property on the corner of 4th and Quaker, north of Greek Circle, the center pivot area, as we call it, and just adjacent to the observatory, which we are not removing in this project. That'll stay. But the commitment by the, not just the committee, but our Board of Regents and presidents at the time, and interim president, and now the new president, was we need to make this happen. When we first visualized this facility, it's now 41,000 square feet, two levels. It has 120 seat capacity auditorium that can be divided into three sections of 40, and by dividable walls. It is high vibrant, or the building is designed so it does not vibrate. The sound acoustician process, or the sound design of the building, is very tight, if you will, much like the chapel was. So the real issue, the concept that came out of the committee, was flexibility and transparency and collaboration. So the whole building was designed around that concept. The original facility was 120,000 square feet. So just for fun, when we first pitched that to the Board of Regents, it was a little challenging to swallow a $60 to $70 million initiative. But they did challenge the president to maybe reduce the cost. We're at a $29 million spend here. The cost per foot is the highest cost per foot that we build on this campus. It's all lab focused and lab centric with collaboration spaces. And we can send you or email you all kind of the metrics of the facility. But the key is it has two levels in about two thirds of the building, two levels that are broken into pods or modular style flex space labs. So everything in there, gases, water, electrical, it's all quick connect. Most of you guys have probably lived in that kind of world before, but we feel like it's going to serve, at least per the committee's needs and the programmatic needs, everything that needs to be done. The unique part about it was we weren't designing for a specific tenant, which somebody's going to talk to you about later. Our mission was to design so that anybody could enter into a lab lease concept, which this building is, and then modify that space on a lease basis. So from lighting, acoustics, utility and infrastructure, the entire site really was designed for, at the end of the day, if this model kicks off, as we think it is going to soon, we'll go into phase two and possibly three and four pretty quickly, either at 40,000 modular building sizes up to 120 or some scale between that. The site can actually handle about 800,000 square foot of research space and collaboration space. So I could go into a lot of technical details about the building. It's a steel structural building, brick veneer, Spanish Renaissance style throughout. It's been vetted a million times on the drawing board to make sure it links to Texas Tech clearly, so it does have that connectivity because it is out on its own. We hope phase two starts quite quickly because we don't want a silo building out there by itself. Public art and landscape enhancements are part of that. We just had 40 submissions to the public art initiative that the committee is reviewing, which is quite a bit. We used to get about 10 to 12 over 5 years ago. Now we're averaging 40 to 50, and that's an international connect into the public art realm. So we've got Africa, North America, South America, and Europe submitting on projects here at Tech, this being one of those. Any question? I mean, I could talk hours about all kinds of fun details, but obviously the renderings, we did not include any of the lab equipment. Many of those spaces will be fitted out. There's two activator labs on the first floor, which will be fully fitted out, so that as Jennifer and the team are bringing people in to maybe join this initiative, they'll have an immediate place. If they need a place to hook up tomorrow, we could do that. And then they will roll into their long-term lease space at a later date. Any questions, or did I cover? Yes, ma'am.
Michael, there's been a report from the National Academies that just came out this fall on laboratory safety and academic facilities. And one of the recommendations in that report is that this move to modular laboratory space that includes office or desk space in the laboratories is not a good idea from a safety standpoint. And I wondered how that And their recommendation is, from the Academy's recommendation, is that there be a shift in architectural standards. And since, as you know, Texas Tech has...
Never had challenges in that.
When there are national discussions of academic laboratory safety, there are always two universities mentioned, UCLA, Texas, and Texas Tech, and Yale, three universities. So even though this is a research park that has an outward looking, maybe under the spotlight.
Yeah, I think you're totally right. I don't, the research sector is certainly on the other side of the podium. People know more about that. But I will, from an architectural perspective, specific to our project, what we tried to do was, at the time, which was a year and a half to 2 years ago, was embody in, on the internal core of the building is where this double-stacked lab concept is. And if you've seen the floor plan, it is outside of those perimeter walls in the capture areas, I would call it, are over 15 to 16 foot deep spaces that are truly, it could be a lab for IT research, or it could be support for that internal core. So we tried to position, not knowing who was going in once again, tried to position that. What it really becomes in this building, because I think there are some architectural standards downstream that we're gonna have to deal with as we continue to grow. I think it's a discipline issue with the people that we partner with in the private sector, which right now that's the primary tenant for these facilities. At least this facility is the private industry. So, which means they'll carry a lot of that risk in the lease contract. But the bottom line is it's on Tech campus, and if something does go wrong, it's the double T that gets announced in the news. So I think as we develop our relationships with these partners, those parameters need to really be defined so that you have space outboard and you have inboard space, and let's use that appropriately. That's a good point. I thought I saw a hand somewhere, maybe not.
There's a question here about whether or not the tenants will fall under OSHA. And I know Jennifer met yesterday with Matt Rowe, who's the new assistant vice president for environmental health and safety. And that is something that...
Yeah, it will be, they'll be required to be OSHA compliant.
Yeah, that is...
They're commercial entities.
Yes, so. And so, but this issue of whether or not you build a laboratory with essentially a glass wall to separate the desks, unlike, for example, what we have at ESB, where the desks are all in the laboratory, that the Academy committee grappled with, you know, that's been an architectural standard, and yet there are reasons that you don't want to do it. So I think MIT right now is probably one of the poster children. They've just built a new, I think it's chemistry and biochemistry building, but it was designed so that the active chemistry is done behind a window.
It's an isolated.
Well, if you're going to work on your computer, you just come around and you're behind a window, so you don't have to have your protective gear on.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, it's much easier for the users, but you have to think about it when you're building.
You know, it's fascinating, just today, and it's been going on for a couple of weeks now, and I cannot remember the gentleman's name in petroleum engineering. He might be in the room. If I forgot your name, I apologize. But we have some chairs like this around, not in the lab space, but over here on the side. And it was selected by the committee. Everybody wanted the comfort, et cetera. And we found out quite quickly, or actually it just came up the other day, that those can be non-porous materials, which we can sweep and pull the seat off, put a new one on, it's not a problem. But down to that minutia, those discussions need to happen. But it wasn't really floated up until a year, you know, almost a year after we're in the building.
And that's
key point. Same, very simple terms, but
it has to be washable if it's in the space.
So we are cognizant of those issues, obviously.
So, what tenants have been identified so far?
I think Jennifer's going to talk about those. So, and I'm not sure all the details. So I'd hate to run down the wrong path. I will say our goal is to be complete in May, by the end of May, probably midnight, the last day, the end of May. I'm kidding. And I know you're negotiating leases with people that's a critical demarc point. We're going to hit that. We'll be ready to move people in. We hope we already start phase two by that time. We hope that this has created enough energy and and buzz, as Dr. Duncan mentioned in the video, that that really happens. And that's always been the plan, is to just been to dovetail this together with several phases at a time, so we don't have to decommission the site and then start back up again. Thank you for your time. Appreciate it. Thanks.
Real quick, Alice, just to further Michael's point, on the separation of office space from lab space, one thing we tried to do as well is we designed the public areas of the building to be not only for comfort but for collaboration. So as you saw on the walkthrough, there's several areas where we have floor to ceiling, glass bark boards, things of that nature, so that those tasks, you know, there's an easy place to handle those tasks rather than bring them into the lab areas.
And one of the issues is, if I'm running a reaction, if an employee is running a reaction, where do they sit to work on the computer? Is there a barrier? That's what the academy will get to.
And I have some floor plans, if anyone wants to look at them, kind of an enlarged version. I'll pass this around if you want to take a gander of that. Had someone ask me yesterday a very good question, and I'm not making fun of the person, it was legitimate. What's the point of all this? You know, who's going to be in this space? What's it for? And that's what I hope to answer a little bit for you today. So there's really four groups that you can identify right off the bat, and I'll zip through these pretty quickly here. The first that we're talking to commercial tenants, this building was funded through commercial bonds. Unlike buildings that are on our campus where we cannot have use by commercial tenants in an educational facility in the ESB, we're limited very much, and other places on campus. But this was financed in such a way that we can have commercial businesses operating out of this facility. We have an advisory board that was formed and has met one time, so we haven't gotten very far along with that progress, but they are going to be the ones who will establish in general criteria or who gets to go into the research part. I've listed some potential considerations here. None of these are single items. It's kind of who's the best overall package and fit. What we have been talking to at this point are industries that either have an existing close relationship already with Texas Tech or a commercial entity that is doing research that aligns really well with things we have going on at Tech. We have some that want to work with Tech researchers. We have some that want to work with Tech students as far as providing internships and so forth. So this is just an idea of the types of things we're looking at. There's not any hard and fast criteria at this point. But basically, if you have someone who's wanting to do applied research, we have several industry partners, really should say numerous industry partners that are located in other parts of the country that love to work with one researcher on the Tech campus. They have long, good relationships with them. This gives them a space that they can lease and have some staff close by to collaborate with Tech researchers. So that is what we talk about, public-private partnerships. That's what we're talking about there. Sometimes we have commercial sponsors that just want to work side by side with our researchers, and we are looking also at those types of commercial entities that will provide internships for our students, that will hire our students after graduation, train students and give them some good exposure to, you know, the industry and where it is. So that's, you know, that's the kind of tangible things we're looking at. Some intangible things as far as why have this research park. Some of the things that are more kind of intangible are the ability to share equipment that is used maybe across campus. If there's certain pieces of equipment we can locate at the research park to allow easier use by researchers and industry, or maybe something that's not being fully utilized on campus and we can bring in revenue that will help with maintain the equipment, service contracts, those sorts of things. It makes it a little easier to attract faculty and faculty spouses that maybe work for industry. You have an opportunity to relocate there and to hopefully attract and retain graduate students. As far as campus use,
as he said, there is a room that will accommodate 120 people. So if you need a space for conferences, for poster competitions, those sorts of things, there's a multi-purpose room that will work really well for that. Small conferences. If you happen to need conference rooms to entertain out-of-town guests, someplace nice to have meetings and that sort of thing, if you don't have something readily available in your department or building, this will be, there's going to be several conference rooms and spaces in this facility. We do have the activator labs. If we have faculty or students that are either have maybe a short project where you need a laboratory short term and you don't want to use that space, we'll have these two laboratories that, as Michael was saying, they're ready to go. They have the hoods, the, you know, everything installed that we could think people might need for where you can just walk in and use it, with the thought that if someone is wanting a space in the building that takes a little while to configure, they can operate out of the activator labs until their space is ready for them to move into it. Another thing is I've encountered faculty that are starting up their own companies, and you get into this, what can I do out of my office in my building, and what should I be doing somewhere else? And you're not supposed to be using tech resources, computers, office space to run a business. So faculty that consult with companies, faculty that are doing research for a company, this gives them a space they can lease to do that. And it's a very high-tech, state-of-the-art facility with the infrastructure that I think would meet just about anyone's need for that sort of activity. People that need just some short-term wet lab space, those sorts of things we can accommodate in the building. Student use, there's enough common areas. You saw whiteboards and gathering areas and that sort of thing. So there'll be a place for students who just want to get together with other students and hash out ideas and talk about whatever. We're seeing a lot of cross-campus collaboration with the new entrepreneurial groups that are starting. So it's a meeting place, and we'll have some space available to those student groups. It's always hard to locate space to meet on campus. It's a little tricky. We will have space there available for those kind of activities for the student groups. Also, you know, for students, hopefully we're hoping to see internships and those sorts of things develop as we bring in different companies. We are talking to several different companies right now, and they're under non-disclosure agreements, so I can't tell you who they are. They're looking at taking up a significant amount of space. We are already, they looked at this building, they're like, well, what if we need more? And so that what we're seeing are perfect candidates that either want part of their operation separate in a building that takes up most of one of these floors of lab space, and they want to get things established for a few years and then possibly develop a bigger space in an adjacent building and move. Another one we've talked to has different parts of its operation. They have a research and development part and another laboratory part, and they like the idea of having one in one building and being able to walk across the parking lot to the other one in a separate building that has kind of a clinical type component to it, so they want it separate. So I've been surprised at what we're seeing as far as people interested in the space, but they're all looking towards, the ones that we've talked to want to use a significant amount of space and are talking about if there's another building available, what they would need in the next building. So it's been gratifying to see that. We also are going to be available for community use. Same thing, meeting spaces, conference rooms, those sorts of things. Sometimes businesses find it a little hard to connect with Texas Tech. This gives them a space to do that. It's a good transition space if someone has a company that's starting up and they need a space for a year or two before they decide if they want to invest in a building here in Lubbock somewhere. So it's a good transition space for, you know, small to moderate size businesses with a research component of some kind. So we're talking with LEDA, the Lubbock Economic Development folks, so that if they come across
things that are compatible with who we want for partners. They can point them our direction. We're going to have venues for community events. And it's a place where LEDA, if they have someone, they're contacted fairly often by people thinking of moving a business to Lubbock or of different sizes. It gives them a space they can say, look what we have here. We've got certain areas that are, we've got buildings that are going to be built in the next couple of years. We've got ready spaces, you know, it's quicker with the infrastructure we have in place to build it out the way they want it. And I wasn't familiar with lab spaces till I got more familiar with the ESB, but this building is built so that you see things in the ceiling. Everything's coming out of the ceiling, all the hookups and everything, so it can be reconfigured very quickly. It's going to be a great space for companies coming in. If you have any questions, you can look on the website. There's photographs, drawing, architectural renderings of the building. Yes?
For the use of something like conference rooms or students needing rooms for faculty from Texas Tech, that's no cost?
No, it'll be. Now, they're probably, as far as conference rooms and that sort of thing, I think if we've got tech, you know, staff and so forth using them, it hasn't all been settled yet, but I would imagine that there's not going to, I wouldn't think there would be a fee for faculty using it for campus, you know, type activities. External people wanting to use it, yes, we would charge for it, I would think. But all of that's kind of, the advisory board's going to be determining that. We're also going to be putting out a listing for an executive director for the research park probably in the next 4 to 5 months maybe. So there will be a staff person in place who will be directing the research park. I'm kind of the in-between person at this point until that person's in place. Yes?
Do you see any potential conflicts with commercial entities or developing products and a lot of students and community people running around and all doing other kinds of events? I'm thinking like, you know, privacy issues, things like that. I mean,
everything is secure access as far as, you may want to address that.
Yeah, the way the building is set up, you've got the public area and the private area. So when you're looking on those floor plans, the northernmost part of the building where the multi-use rooms, the atrium and all the common areas, that's all in the public sector of the building. The doors into the lab areas are controlled access. So and we did that specifically for that reason, because we knew we would have a lot of public involvement in the main part. And we want that because we want this to be a show place. Not only to promote Texas Tech, but to promote the research park and help us develop the rest of the site. But we wanted to make sure that everything going on in the back, that, you know, we're maintaining confidentiality for the commercial partners, and we're maintaining safety by not allowing a lot of people to run around the area where they shouldn't be at.
And we are talking with environmental health and safety to make sure that the commercial part of it complies with all of our, you know, requirements. It's, you know, the minimum standard will be Texas Tech's environmental health and safety. They will have additional things such as OSHA they have to comply with, but we're very cognizant of the safety issues involved. Yes?
When you lease this space to the commercial users, you are just becoming a landlord for that particular facility and you just lease the space, or are they expected to interact with the students and the faculty in their research development? Because I have seen some research parks where you give the space, they just manufacture it and just use it just like as leased space. So right. We really don't gain much benefit having them as a on the campus. Okay. Are there any limitations where they're expected to interact with the faculty and other students? Something like that, which has got two-way type of thing.
Right, and I've been discussing some of these issues with people that run other research parks. Some research parks require an ongoing research relationship with the university. You know, you can't, they'll allow a few months to go by without a project being in place. So there's ways to deal with that. We're kind of early on to have that nailed down in lease terms yet, but I will say that people, we're not even considering groups that don't have a pretty good connection already with Texas Tech researchers. So we're being very cautious about who we are talking to at this point. And but you're absolutely right. It could be that way, especially in a bigger park. But there's ways to deal with it in lease agreements that, you know, there has to be an ongoing research component or something. I don't know how Tech will choose to do that, but it's very good to keep bringing that up.
Involvement of the students in their project.
Yes, involving the students in their...
Very valuable.
Yes, I agree. Yes.
Do you see this as something that faculty could or should be putting in proposals to MSF or NIH, and they can say, we have the space, but then we would need to put in our budget that we need to rent it out if it's something like, I don't have a laboratory, but I can use this during my time in the grant, and it's cost this much per year. Is that something that you guys see as a use of this space?
I don't know at this point. I would recommend talking to Dr. Duncan about that, and I'll ask. I would, you know, if there's space available and you're going after something like that and you can afford to rent the space, you know, then I think that's reasonable. I just don't know. I can't speak for Dr. Duncan, so we'd need to talk to him about that.
Okay, so this is really more for outside industry to come in?
It's a combination. It's for both. It's for both, but whoever is taking up the space has to have the ability to lease the space.
Okay.
So that would probably depend on the nature of what's allowed in a grant budget, perhaps.
Now, as a follow-up to our question, when you're writing a major research instrumentation project to NSF, where we wanted to bring $1 million piece of equipment, which can be shared amongst the different research groups.
Right.
Is there any room in that type of an application, or everything is commercialization type of thing?
There's room for location of shared use equipment in the facility, and I think that would definitely be considered. In fact, that's part of the purpose of it, is to have a place where we can do that.
If you can put one of the bullets in your presentation, that would be nice to say, this is a room where the shared instrumentation or big ticketed items can be located in that particular place. I think that would be one benefit, because we really don't have access to the facilities located in other buildings and other departments when you're working on an interdisciplinary project.
Okay.
Yeah, along the same lines, how much IT space is allocated to that?
Excuse me?
How much IT space?
What do you mean as far as?
Like computer rooms? I mean, all of these commercial companies are going to need servers, they're going to need, where are they going to go?
We have that set up, on each floor there are two IDF rooms. One is dedicated for Texas Tech telecommunications use. There's an adjacent room that will be available for tenants. That's where the AT&T lines will come in for their phone and internet usage. If they have servers, we can accommodate them to a certain extent in those rooms.
You know how much? I'm just curious. I mean, how much power is going in? How much?
I'd have to look at the prints. And a lot of that's going to depend upon what the tenant needs are. You know, we have the ability to bring in, you know, pretty much whatever they need. But you know, those rooms, they're not massive. They're about the size of a typical telecommunications closet you would see anywhere else.
Five by five, 10 by 10?
Bigger than that, I'd have to look at floor plan. See, now that being said, there's office space, or there's bays adjacent to those rooms where the office spaces would go. If a tenant has a need for additional space for servers, what have you, they can lease that space and we can build it out to accommodate those pieces of equipment, make sure there's proper ventilation, proper cooling, those sorts of things.
Okay. So we don't run out of time for Ryan. Ryan Reber's going to talk to us about the accelerator program here at TECH.
Thank you, Jennifer. My name is Ryan Reber. I'm the director of the TECH Accelerator program, which is under the Office of Research Commercialization. I just want to give you just some quick context before I jump into the TECH Accelerator or the Texas Tech Accelerator, give you some context into what our office does, and that'll really help help with the explanation of why and kind of what we're doing. So the Office of Research Commercialization really exists to protect and transfer innovations and discoveries that are being developed at Texas Tech University, transfer those to the marketplace. And we do this for a number of reasons. Reputation for the university. Students these days, you know, because of the success of Mark Zuckerberg and Facebook, they want to go develop their own entrepreneurial story. So they want to go to entrepreneurially minded schools. Provides a service to the faculty, provides revenue back to the university. It's job creation for the state and for the region. So there's a number of other benefits that go along with why we transfer innovations from the university into the marketplace. This is a good diagram of the process of research to commercialization, and really what we're doing is generating revenue that's going to flow back into research. And really from here, you can see that the research funding, as most of you all know, really comes from two sources, private sources and public sources. Large majority of that funding is federally funded research, but as you know, federal funds only are only really intended for the discovery of an idea. They're not really intended for the commercialization. The federal government's mindset is, we'll fund discovery, we're not here to fund commercialization. That's really where the private sector is supposed to engage. And so there's this natural gap that exists where an idea is made and where it's at in its development and where the private sector wants to engage. Private sector doesn't mind taking risk to take early stage technology out of university, but they want to take calculated risk. So a lot of the technology that gets developed at the university is considered early stage to the corporates and to the private industry. And so really, because of that, what we're doing is providing a de-risking mechanism for the private sector. So this is tech transfer simplified. We protect the ideas at the university, and then we license them out to the private sector. There's two groups that we license technology to. One, to existing companies, Fortune 100 companies, GE, Halliburton, those types of companies. And the other is to startups. And so there's this need to support startup companies because they're, by nature, more risky. There's more risk associated with them. They need to raise funding. They don't have as many resources as the existing companies. And so what we're doing, and as part of the innovation hub, that's the vision with the research park and with the vision of Dr. Duncan, is to develop more resources, to develop an ecosystem that helps support startup companies. So the Texas Tech Accelerator is one mechanism that we can support more startup companies and support the creation of more startup companies. So the Texas Tech Accelerator, and the Tech Accelerator is what we had termed it in the past. We'll end up having to change that name. But what we're really trying to address is that commercialization gap, where technologies are early stage at the university, and we're building out commercial plans to help de-risk them for the private sector, in hopes that we're creating more startup companies that can go raise private money so that they can bring those technologies forward to the marketplace. So the way our program works is we combine innovations that are being developed at the university with entrepreneurs and with students, provide them mentorship from the private sector, and provide seed funding to help them develop a commercial plan. And then we walk them through a program and a process similar to the Lean Startup methodology, similar to NSF I-Corps programs. And we're working with venture capitalists and various other groups to develop exactly what that process looks like. So it's a four-month program where we, at the end, we're not developing technology, we're not building prototypes. What we're doing is building commercial plans and really developing an investment pitch so that you can go get investor dollars, which is highly important to moving technology forward. This is really what our process looks like. So we open applications in the fall and we review candidates, select our candidates in the fall, and then we kick off the program in January. We provide seed money during the program to help these companies go talk to customers. That's a large focus of what we're doing is engaging with the private sector and validating the business assumptions before we enter the marketplace. And so our program runs from January to May, and it culminates in Demo Day. And Demo Day is our platform that we create to give these teams and these companies the opportunity to pitch to a room full of investors. Last year, we piloted the Tech Accelerator. We had over 100 participants at our Demo Day event. We had three companies from our accelerator present, and then we had five other regional companies present. And so this year, we'll look forward to making that a bigger event, having more investors come to the event. One of our ventures at our Demo Day this past year was actually able to raise money from people that were in the audience that were investors, and so they're actually moving forward with commercialization. And so if we didn't have a program and we didn't invite investors to come to demo day, that story, that startup would never have been founded, jobs would not have been created, they would not, the technology would still be at the university and would not be moving forward to commercialization. That technology is a technology that can improve the rate at which we can identify new drug candidates. So that technology could be really important to society and potentially lessen the cost of developing drugs and providing solutions quicker to the marketplace. So really what, you know, our goal is simply tech transfer. We're trying to get technologies out the door, and this is one mechanism that we can do that. This is just a quick slide on sort of what our process is. As you can see, most of what we're focused on, and I really should move product development away from this, because really what we're focused on is market validation and business model development. So beyond the tech accelerator, beyond tech transfer, we're trying to build that innovation hub. We're trying to build that ecosystem here that supports startup companies. And a lot of that takes place with, you know, you need funding, you need organized capital in the region. You need service providers that can provide discounted services to startups. You need mentors. You need a lot of functions within the ecosystem that can support populations within the ecosystem. This is just a small graph that we came up with that really shows sort of the culture of innovation that's being built out at Texas Tech. And I might be missing a few things, but you know, there's the bottom is really focused on collaboration and education, and the top is really focused on pulling out ideas into the marketplace. So funding, the mechanisms to get funding, the research part, you know, incubators, accelerators, venture funds, those types of things. So you know, really to wrap it up, you know, it's often said that there's three things are needed to have a successful startup company. You need an idea, you need money, and you need people. And so, you know, what we're trying, you know, we're sitting on a hotbed of ideas at the university. And so we're trying to build out the mechanisms to match those ideas with entrepreneurs and then give them funding. So we're working on the aspects to build out that ecosystem here at Texas Tech to support startups. And that's important, you know, primarily to you, because we're trying to get your inventions into commercialization, into the marketplace. Generates a return back to the university, generates a return back to your research labs, and back into your pockets as well, and can provide recognition for some of the innovations that you're developing, which are highly important problems that you're solving for society. So I'm happy to take, I think we're running out of time. I'll stick around for a few minutes if anyone has any questions.
The seed funding, private dollars, or are they state dollars that carry state disclosure and state compliance regulations?
So they're external dollars outside the university. And we're, there'll be an announcement later this month where we'll be able to clarify that a little bit more.
But they're dollars from the private sector? Or are they dollars that carry the sorts of compliance and disclosure requirements that we have because we're a state institution?
Mm-hmm. That's a really good question, and we'll have to look into that a little bit more. And the funding isn't completely finalized, so we'll, as we finalize that's an issue that we'll have to look into and address that.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, I'll stick around for a few minutes if anyone has any questions. Feel free to talk to me.
Thank you.